Hello and welcome to the Dawn Jarvis Show, where our goal is to inspire you by interviewing a diverse range of visionary leaders, entrepreneurs, and sharing their entrepreneurial journey. Today, we have a very special guest, Jacynth Ivey, who will be sharing great tips on her journey from being a nurse to being a successful entrepreneur. Jacynth is an award-winning transformational coach and leader with decades of experience working with individuals and organizations worldwide who are successful business owners, entrepreneurs, managers, and leaders who are struggling with their self-worth, which is affecting their overall performance in their everyday life and business. She launched her career as a nurse, midwife, and health visitor, and becoming an executive director of nursing. She found her true passion in developing people and organizations and supporting them to achieve their goals and aspirations. Jacynth Ivey, welcome to the show. How are you?
I am very well, thank you, Dawn, and thank you for having me here today. It's a real pleasure, and it's always a pleasure to be in your company.
Oh, thank you so much. It's so good to see you. I've been doing some work with you recently, so it's really good to spend this time so we can share about you. Often, we're often teaching or doing other things, so it'd be really good to hear your journey today. Now, I've known Jacynth for a long time, actually. The first time I met you was about 18 years ago. I think I was on a course that you were teaching about how to get that job. So it's amazing to see you now. And we do some work together and we have some mutual friends as well. The first thing I ask people and on my show is, how did you get to where you are today? So it's been a bit of a journey for you, hasn't it, Justin?
It has. And when I was 18, as you said, I went into nursing. And when I started nursing in those days, it was a job for life. You went into a job for life. And so I never dreamed that I wouldn't continue to work in the National Health Service. And so I became a nurse, became a health visitor. I was a midwife. I moved up the ranks, became a director of nursing, and worked there for a little while. And then something happened, and usually something happens really that really kind of sometimes dramatically changes your course. And something happened. The NHS, one of the constants I always say in the NHS is change. And we'd gone through a rapid period of change. And actually, I realized at that point that actually my purpose was best served elsewhere. I have a real passion for developing people, real passion for developing organizations. And at that strategic level, yes, there were elements that I could do, but actually I felt a little constrained. And so I took a leap of faith, Dawn. I took a leap of faith. I didn't have a business plan. I didn't have some fancy strategy. I'd made a decision to leave. I'd got two young children, single parent, house, mortgage, all of those trappings. But I took a leap of faith and left at that point in time.
Wow. That's amazing. And because I think it takes a lot of courage to do that, doesn't it, really? And to decide that your talents are best served elsewhere, they're best utilized elsewhere. And then to do that, being a single parent, having two young children, and deciding to do that. And I think that is quite an inspiring story for a lot of people, because they might think that they can't do that, that it's not possible to do that, that their circumstances might dictate that they can't do that. But that's not the case, is it, Jacynth?
It isn't the case. And the other thing that really made my decision is I hadn't appreciated how strong my core values were around fairness, equity, justice. And when I saw them being compromised within all of these change processes, I just felt I couldn't be part of that as well. So there was something about my core beliefs as well as my purpose that really helped me to make that decision. And oftentimes I find when I'm working with individuals, when they say things don't feel right, but they can't put their finger on it, and I talk to them about their values, it's often when their values, when your values are compromised, It's one of those things, you're not quite sure what it is, but something doesn't feel right.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I realized that my values have been compromised. And in order to be true to myself, I needed to just exit.
Oh, wow.
So that's what I did.
That's amazing. And now you're the managing director of two companies, Inspiring Hope and JacynthIvey.com. And you do charity, you support organizations, and you also support individuals. How is that different from the NHS?
So how is it different from the NHS? In my one organization, Inspiring Hope, I work predominantly with the NHS. And what I bring, I suppose, that is different in a sense from maybe other consultancy companies is my lived experience of being in the NHS.
Yeah.
But also a lot of the work that I do is increasingly focused around equality and diversity, but particular race equality. And so, of course, I've got lived experience of being a Black woman, lived experience of being a patient in the NHS, lived experience of being a clinician, a director in the NHS, and I'm also a non-executive director. So I bring all of that experience to bear. I think I've been able to utilize all of that. So some people might think, well, you left this really good career in nursing, what a waste. But it isn't a waste because I'm putting back in a different way. So in a different way, holding the organizations to account through my non-executive role, but also supporting organizations to be the best place, the most equitable place they can be for their workforce, and also ensure that they give really good care to everybody, irrespective of their background. So that's how I bring kind of my previous experience to bear with Inspiring Hope. And with JacynthIvey.com, again, drawing on my experiences around, particularly around how we develop leaders and individuals to be their true authentic self. That is, people who know me know that's my mantra, is about being your authentic self, acknowledging your brilliance, because I think life can put us down, Dawn.
Yeah, it can.
Life puts us down where we feel we don't fit in, we don't belong. I can't apply for that job because I don't think I'm going to get it because the job's been earmarked. Mm-hmm. So we have a number of kind of challenges that happen in life that just put us down. And I believe that there's brilliance in all of us. And so that's the work that I do through JacynthIvey.com.
That's amazing. So first of all, I love that you're bringing a different perspective based on your lived experience and your working experience back to the NHS. And I think that's so, so important. I think, you know, having worked in the NHS and doing some similar kind of work, that it's really important to have an outside view. What's it like to experience those services? What's it like to be a manager in those services? What's it like to lead in those services? So I think it's really great to have a unique perspective. And I think that's really, really valuable. And secondly, I think through your journey and through everything and the work you're doing in JacynthIvey.com, you're really, you know, helping people to acknowledge their brilliance, which is what we're going to mainly talk about today. And that, so how do people acknowledge their brilliance, Jacyn?
Well, there's, as I said, my starting point is there is brilliance in absolutely everybody. And I've developed a 7-step model around how to acknowledge your brilliance, which I, when I'm working with clients or talking with individuals I work through. And the first thing is that we have to acknowledge that we are different. We all have a different story. We have a different backstory. When I talk about my backstory, it starts in the Windrush era. And no, I'm not that old, but my parents came here in Windrush era. They faced many challenges when they were here, and that helped to build our resilience. So I saw my parents going through challenges, heard their stories, and the messages that they gave us around being yourself, doing the best that you can be. You are different in society. So that, my story helped me to really begin to understand who I am. And then when I think about, and I told you about my values, mm-hmm. actually my values make me. Mm-hmm. And my values are clear, and I live, walk and talk my values.
Yeah.
So it's really important to acknowledge who you are. So many of us don't really know who we are. We accept what others tell us Yes, you're not very good. You could be brighter, you need to be fatter, thinner, smaller, taller. You need to be like, there are so many people that are willing to tell you a story of you that is not your story.
Mm-hmm.
And so it really is important to acknowledge who you are and to remember that it's your story that shapes you. So if you don't like the story, go back and you can't change the past, but if you don't like the story, I always say, tell yourself a new story.
Oh, I love that. I love that. Tell yourself a new story. And you don't have, yes, I love the fact you're saying you're not defined by your past. I mean, the past is the past, it's happened, and you can't do anything about it, but you can learn from it and you can decide what you want to do and, you know, what you want your story to be going forward, which is lovely. So one of the things that you talk about is how to untap your true potential so that you can tell yourself, you know, tell a new story. So how do people do that, Jacynth?
Yes. So it really is getting back with self. So again, some of that untapping true potential is about removing all of the self-doubt, mm-hmm. the procrastination, the, you know, all of that, that help that keeps us back and say, okay, so how do we do that? So telling ourselves a different story is incredibly important. And telling ourselves a story that says, I can. Yes, that in all things, everything is possible if we just believe. And that's really, really important. And so often when I'm working with clients and I'll say to them, well, just list all of the things that you can do, that you have done. Don't stop and think, well, I wasn't very good at that, or was I really good at that? Just start to list all of the things, all of the experiences, all of the things that you've done, the things that you know, whether it's baking a cake, whether it's writing a complex strategy, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. Because what you're doing is you're starting to change the narrative, change the belief, because our minds can really hold us back. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the things that's really important is I say it's around how we guard our mind. And there are so many naysayers around. And so we need to be very mindful of the people that we who are our friends and that we have as our company,
mm-hmm.
because we really need to surround ourselves by people who have either walked the journey or a similar journey, who can support and enhance you, who can help to pull you up, or who are going on the same path as you.
Mm-hmm.
And so often we hold on to people. And one of the things I say is that when we have, you know, if you can imagine a chest of drawers and you've got all of your clothes, different clothes in your chest of drawers, well, actually, you know, throughout time, you change things in those chest of drawers. You discard things, you move things from maybe being best to, you know, you demote them maybe to everyday wear, or you get rid of them. It's the same with our friends and acquaintances. We need to do a review and a clear out every now and again to ensure that the people that we surround ourselves are going where we want to go. We need to review the things that we read and the things that we watch. And instead of some of those books, some of the fiction, it's maybe you want to read autobiography, mm-hmm. or some of the popular psychology, you know, read something that is going to edify your mind.
Yeah.
Yes. And it's the same with what we watch. It's really important.
Yeah, I think it is really important. And particularly when you decide what you're going to do and decide what you're good at, and then you need to sort of develop that. I really like what you said about when a person might not think that they were very good at it, but they can choose to be good at it, and they can develop that skill. It's all like muscles, isn't it? Developing
those
things. And so by reading and watching the things that are going to help you with your goals, I think it that'll go some way to untapping your true potential. Would you agree, Jacynth?
I absolutely would agree. And I heard a great phrase yesterday. So often we talk about time management, and I don't quite like that,
mm-hmm.
you know, because that says time is managing me. But this individual talked about choice management, and I really like that,
yeah.
because we can choose how we spend our time. We are all given 24 hours. Imagine if it was £24. We mm-hmm. can choose how we spend each of those hours. It's our choice. And I really like that, because it helped to shift your mind about what it is that you do with mm-hmm. your time. So if you've chosen to sit and do nothing, if you've chosen to sit and worry, if you've chosen to sit and procrastinate, that's a choice you've made.
Wow, I love that. I love the analogy with money, actually. I was just thinking about that while you were talking, because I was thinking, because imagine if we were given £24,000 and then, you know, and every hour was £1,000 that you chose how you spent it. You would soon be really careful with how you spent it, but also and I still think you would choose to actually do nothing, because or choose to get somebody else to do something for you. Because one of the things that I think about when delegating, for example, is how valuable is my time?
Absolutely.
How valuable is my time? And if you put like a monetary value on the hours of your day, that is a great way to sort of like think about how valuable is your time, you know, how valuable is your sleep time, how valuable is, you know, the time you spend, you know, reading or talking to people, you know, how valuable is your time? You know, I know that you talk about measuring success and stuff like that in your work as well. So I think I really, really like that. I like that a lot.
Yeah. And I have a small team for that reason, that actually I suddenly thought, I actually don't need to be doing this mm-hmm. because if by doing this, that means actually I'm not doing the client facing work mm-hmm. that actually, you know, that I need to do to build up the business. And so sometimes people think it's kind of indulgent, perhaps, particularly in a small business, to have staff, to have administrative staff. It's not. It's a necessity. You have to think about what is it that only you can do in and on the business. And then therefore, what else can be delegated? What can somebody else do that enables you to do what you do best? Yes, because that's what brings the business in. That's what sustains you. So if you're busy doing administrative tasks, then you're not actually busy doing the business, doing the work, doing what it is that you have the skill, knowledge, expertise to do. And so it's really important. And sometimes we think, oh, we can't afford it. My question is, can you afford not to?
Oh, wow. Yes, really, really wise words. So, and you also talk about, and this is a bit of what you were just saying, actually, that it's really important to care for your mind, body and soul as part of this process. So talk to me a little bit about that.
So when I was, excuse me a second. So on my kind of entrepreneurial journey, I was really fixated on, you know, kind of every day doing the business, not really thinking about my health. And I went on this amazing seminar where actually they talked about kind of business strategy, but they also talked about health. And I thought, wow, this is really interesting. And I've got to learn more about it, and went on this amazing program in Switzerland. And so actually, there are 8 tenets to health that we need to think about. Often we just think about it in relation to maybe diet and exercise. Mm-hmm. Yes, and that's our health. And increasingly we're thinking about mindfulness. But there are lots of other things. We have to think about the air that we breathe. So we have to think about the green agenda and what's our role within that green agenda. But also, so many of us don't practically breathe properly. We're breathing from a pier instead of breathing from our diaphragm. Now, as a nurse, you know what happens when we breathe in. We breathe in oxygen into our body, which we need for all of our vital organs. And so it's really important to think about how we breathe. It's important to think about the fluid intake that we, you know, how we drink. We don't drink enough water. We should always have a glass of water at the side. So it's the air we breathe. It's the water we drink. We have to think about the food that we eat, the thoughts that we think. So I talked about that, guard your mind, the words that we speak, because we can speak life or death into ourselves. Mm-hmm. Yeah, by going back to the stories that we tell ourselves. We need to think about the moves that we make. So it's not excessive energetic exercise, but actually, do we get up? Do we walk around? Do we stretch? We need to think about the things that we seek. So that's the things that we look at. I talked about that earlier in terms of reading, and how we sleep, the sleep that we take. So the mantra is the air we breathe, the water we drink, the food we eat, thoughts we think, the words we speak, the moves we make, the things we seek, the sleep we take.
Wow. So
that's the mantra for the pillars of wellness.
I love that. That's amazing. I love that. That is really, really good. So I'll talk to you a little bit about how you do that later. But first of all, I want to talk about your book. Tell us about your book, Jacynth.
So my book is called It's Okay to Be Different, Reignite Your Passion, Fulfill Your Dreams. And when I was writing this book, it was really based on my life and my experience of growing up in a predominantly white middle class environment, about being the only Black child in the class. And some of the, at the time, I didn't always appreciate it was racism, but actually some of the things that used to happen to me when I look back throughout my schooling. And so it's born off some of those experiences of being married very young and being divorced, being a single parent, of going through education system, some of the issues in my career, in terms of my faith and some of the issues around church. Mm-hmm. Always, when I look back, feeling a sense of I didn't quite fit in. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've ever felt like that, Dawn, but you kind of feel like you're on the margins. It's almost like sometimes having an out-of-body experience, looking down, thinking, am I really here? Is this really what I'm meant to be doing? And then what that does to your psyche. Mm-hmm. And so I really kind of reflected on my life and where I am now, and thought about, well, what are the strategies that I used, that actually I employed to get me to where I am, but not only to get me to where I am, that I continue to use with myself and with my clients when I'm coaching. And so the seven steps are, so I talked earlier about the acknowledging that you are different, mm-hmm. and the importance of that and authenticity. The next step was really kind of beginning to understand what your purpose is, your why. The why is one of the most important questions, because if you don't know your why or your purpose, then you've got no reason, almost no reason to get up in the morning. But there's no reason for you to continue in whatever sphere. And so it was really to understand my purpose. And as I said, I really understood what my values were. And so whatever I did needed to be aligned to those values. And then I began to realize that actually my purpose was to support and enable, my mission in life was to support and enable individuals and organizations to be the best that they could be. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And whatever that meant, and particularly in relation to organizations, it came from an employee perspective, that all employees should have a sense of belonging, irrespective of who they are. Mm-hmm. Irrespective of their protected characteristic, they should be able to take their whole self to work and be who they want to be. So discovering your reason why and your purpose is absolutely key to think about why you are here. And then thinking about, okay, so we know why we're here. But then often people get sidetracked, and it's really important to focus. And one of the analogies I use is that, you know, for those of us who drive, do you drive, Dawn?
I do.
You do? Uh-huh. So how often do you look in the rearview mirror?
I don't know, actually. I want to start.
Okay, so
I am looking ahead most of the time.
You're looking ahead most of the time. Okay. But so many, absolutely. And every now and again, you look in the rearview mirror. And if we equate that to life, so many of us, so many people are going through life looking in the rearview mirror.
Yeah.
Looking at the past, looking at what went wrong, focusing on what went wrong, and they've gone down that spiral instead of being really clear and laser focused. We know our reason why, we know our purpose. Let's be laser focused. Let's keep, imagine going on a really winding country lane when you've got to really hold on to the, mm-hmm. to the wheel. I was in Dorset last week driving on a country lane, and I gripped the wheel like this, and I was driving laser focused. And that's how we have to be with our career, with our aspirations, our business, is to be laser focused. Don't get distracted. And there's a, you know, don't get distracted by shiny pennies, something that comes off to the right or to the left, where you think, oh, that looks interesting, let me go down there, you know, yeah. Well, that's interesting, I'm going to go down there now. It takes you off course.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so it's going to take you longer to get to your destination. So keep laser focused. The other thing I talk about in the book is around choosing to take action. So we can have the most amazing action plans. We can do them electronically. We can do them picture. We can have spreadsheets. We can do all of this stuff. Brilliant. Whichever one suits you, whichever one floats your boat. But if we don't physically then do something that is written on that action plan, then it makes no sense. Mm-hmm. So we've got to physically choose to take an action, not just write them down. We have to actually get up and action the actions. And that might sound quite simple, but so many people have action plans. It's like making a New Year's resolution 3 months down the line. Oh, I forgot to do that.
Yeah.
So it's important that we choose to take action. I talked earlier, and I talk about in the book about guarding your mind, and I talked about that, and I talk about distraction burglaries. and that concept came to me from I read something about how a number of senior people were being distracted. The doorbell would go, they'd be distracted, and somebody would go around the back and steal from their home.
Oh wow.
Yes. Have you not heard of that?
No.
They get distracted by the door and they get held at the door, and then there's an accomplice who goes around, enters the house and steals. And I thought, that's what happens with our minds. Distraction, burglary, is that somebody will distract us with something that says all this negativity. Yes. And whilst they're doing that, they're robbing us of our joy, robbing us of our creativity, robbing us of our ideas. Mm-hmm. So it's really important to be aware of that distraction that robs you of that creativity, the joy, the idea. And then I talk about you are measured by what you do. One of the chapters talks about that. So again, that's going back to taking action. And it's to set yourself some milestones. Yes, because sometimes our why is a big why. We might say, I want to buy, you know, a four-bedroomed house by the sea, and I'm currently living or renting an apartment. And I might feel I'm never going to get there. So I need to set myself some milestones that I can celebrate along the way. I might need to go and buy a semi-detached house first. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so I might want to celebrate that. But that celebration needs to be proportionate to our achievement. So if I've just, you know, achieved something, I don't know, I've had a conversation with somebody who I've been trying to have a conversation with forever, and that's a real achievement, I'm not going to take myself on a Caribbean cruise because that's not proportionate to that achievement. Yeah, yeah. But, you know, set yourself your milestones and celebrate those. And then the last one is dare to dream. So many of us, so many people, Dawn, I don't know what how you find this, think it's a waste of time dreaming, you know, to sit, to do nothing. Like, it's a waste of time. People think they should be doing something all the time, busy, 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 and yeah. Never give themselves time to think or time to dream.
I think I might be guilty of the busy, busy, busy. We've talked about that before, but I think it's really important to set that time aside. And actually, I'm taking some lessons from Jacynth here and sort of like, you know, actually scheduling time, some downtime is really, really important, isn't it?
It is really
important.
It is.
I really like that. So that's your book. That's amazing. I love that. And it's a real achievement to have written a book, isn't it, really? Did you enjoy the process?
I did, actually. I did. And in the process, I took time out to think. Uh-huh. I absolutely did take time out to think. And actually, I wrote the basis of the book. I was on a two-week holiday to Barbados with my husband. Lovely. And I would get up every morning at about 6 o'clock, and I would write solidly for 2 to 3 hours. I didn't think about, oh, don't want to put that, don't want to put that. I didn't edit as I went and correct. I just wrote solidly what was in my head, in my heart, and from my experiences, and then went back after that to edit. Yeah. So again, I took the limitations off my mind because you think, writing a book, where do you start?
Yeah, I like that. I like that. I like that process. It's really, really nice. Because I think you'll find when you go back on it, you'll think, oh, can't believe I wrote that. Yeah, that's amazing. Right. And then, you know, and then I think that, so the only thing is you might find it difficult to take things out, but it's good to see it all there. And it's always good for backup. When I wrote my book, there's lots of notes that didn't go in the book, but they're useful. Yes. And going forward and for social media and things like that. So how do people get hold of the book, Jacynth?
So if they go to my website, which is www.jacynthivey.com, and if they look in resources, they'll be able to order the book. Also as well, they can get 3 free chapters from the book. So you can download them on the website. So all the information is there on the website.
Brilliant. And we will include that information in the show notes. So don't worry about having to remember the website as well. So we have talked a lot actually about how to care for your mind, body and soul, which actually leads it very nicely into this bit, which I ask everyone about. So as a nurse, it's been my experience being a business owner that you can let the health and wellness stuff slide because you're so focused on the business. I've already admitted to being busy. So I ask all of my guests, I ask them 2 questions. How do they stay focused, positive and productive? Because I think there needs to be a lot of resilience about being a business owner, being an entrepreneur. So how do they manage that part of their journey? And the other thing is, how do they personally manage their health and well-being, keeping an eye on that? And the reason I asked that is because I did a time audit on myself when I started. Because I say to my clients, and then audit your time, see how you're spending your time. And I was absolutely horrified that I was doing 18-hour days, not getting up from this chair, and you know, not eating and drinking properly, and definitely not sleeping properly. So Jacynth Ivey, how do you manage?
Yeah, so I stay focused, positive and productive because I've got a really strong reason why. Mm-hmm. Yeah, really strong reason why. I know my purpose, I know my past, I know what it is that I want to achieve. And so that drives me. And that's not just about me. Some people think, oh, that's just about kind of wanting to earn X amount of money. It's not. It goes back to my mission and my passion, which is enabling others and organizations to be the best that they can be. And so that really keeps me focused in terms of ensuring I deliver and provide an absolutely top quality product and service. To look after me is an active process. Mm-hmm. So because it won't just happen. So I've been there, Dawn, and often in danger of going there, or I need to draw myself back, mm-hmm. where I'm just so focused on the work that I suddenly think, oh my goodness, it's getting dark. You know, I need to turn the light on, or I haven't eaten all day. And so just like when I talk about in my book, scheduling time to think, we have to schedule in our time to look after ourselves. So that may mean getting up a little bit earlier. I'm not one for going to the gym, but it may be getting up a little bit earlier. I really try and drink more water. So I have a glass of water beside me. So it's really important that we drink water. But it's to think about, what is it you need to do? What is it you're trying to achieve during the day? So for me, I want to make sure I move more. Yeah, so I'm not going to go and exercise. I won't lie. I'm not going to the gym. I'm not going to exercise. I need to move more. That might mean though for me, how many times a week I'm going to go walking. For some, they will schedule and can schedule in every day. Mm-hmm. And we know that we should do at least 30 minutes activity daily. And so for me, it's an active process. I make sure I drink regularly water. I make sure I plan in 3 meals a day. That is sometimes difficult, mm-hmm. if I've got a really busy schedule. Yeah. But what I do now is the meal that I've prepared the evening before, there's a little bit left, I put in the fridge and I have that at lunchtime. And so it has to be proper planning in order to look after yourself. But I know you'll have heard me say this lots and lots of times, get your mind right. Mm-hmm. Yes, get your mind right, and then everything else actually will begin to follow and will fall into place. And one of the most important things that I think is scheduling time for your friends.
Yeah,
for your friends and your loved ones. You know, scheduling your diary, you know, afternoon tea with a friend, morning coffee with a friend, lunch with a friend, schedule it in your diary, particularly for the people that are important in your life, because before you know it, you've months have gone, weeks have gone, you've not had a face-to-face contact, particularly post-pandemic,
mm-hmm.
yeah, or worse still, something has happened. So that's really important.
That's really great. I love that. Thank you so, so much for that. That's really good advice. So how do people get hold of you, Jacynth, if they want to speak to you, work with you, have you part of their organisation? How do people get in contact with you?
So they contact me through the website, jacynthivey.com, and through the contacts page. So if you just go directly to the contacts page, and whatever it is, however you'd like me to support you, send that email and we will respond. Or indeed, you can book and schedule a discovery call with myself through the website.
Brilliant. And you're on social media, aren't you, Jacynth?
I am. I'm on LinkedIn, Jacynth Ivey. You can join my Facebook group, which is Acknowledge Your Brilliance. So if you're on Facebook, if you look for Acknowledge Your Brilliance, I'm on Twitter, Jacynth Ivey, or Inspiring Hope 3. And I'm also on Instagram. So yes.
Yeah. And we'll put all of those links into the show notes, so you don't need to, you won't miss them, don't worry. So Jacynth, it's been an absolute pleasure to have you here, to have this chat, to hear all about you, your journey, your values and your story. Thank you so much for being here. Do you have one last, you know, actionable tip for our audience that they can take away with them?
One last tip is I love Maya Angelou and some of her quotes. And one of the quotes that I often use is that people forget what you said, but people never forget how you made them feel. And so for me, it's really important that we are kind to each other. We are kind to ourselves, but we are kind to each other. And I just want to leave people with that tip.
I love that. I love Maya Angelou. I love that tip. I might steal that one for myself, actually, in interviews. So Jacynth, thank you so much. That's it for the Dawn Jarvis Show. It's been another good one. If you like what you heard or saw, please like, share, subscribe. Let us know what you think in the comments. I'd really love to know as well. And I will see you really soon. Take care. Bye.